Okay, so we'll just move on to the heart of the machine and why it works the way that it works, which is the manufacturing of the spiral rollers, or the spiral segments, if you want to call it that. So I've got a little selection on here. I've got some different types that are available when you purchase the machine. And I'll just talk you through them and basically how they work. So we'll start off with this one. So this is as you can see, it's air chambers inside. We can see straight through, so very deformable. This particular one has four ribs on it, and they measure 6 millimeters high, or 1/4 inch. Now, this is our preferred roller for small potatoes. The idea is that the rib is lower than our standard main crop version. So we've got main crop ones on this machine, which are 10 millimeters high with 6 ribs. This one here is 6 millimeter. So as you can imagine, it's a less aggressive tread pattern and less likely to pull smaller or slightly ugly shaped potatoes. So if you've got a situation which would be salad potatoes or these little gourmet potatoes, perhaps they're quite long and unusual shapes, not particularly round, there's more likelihood that the standard spiral roller could just pinch the end of that potato. In generally dry conditions, that's when we're thinking about not being too aggressive with a separator. So we came up with this roller just quite a few years ago, and the idea is it reduces its effectiveness as for cleaning. So the rib is less aggressive, it's not able to pull so much soil and so many stones through, but generally speaking, on reasonable soils, lighter soils, where you perhaps would grow the smaller potatoes, this would be the weapon of choice, quite honestly. So just as effective on horm, it will pinch the horm between the rib of the roller and the cob roller here, and it will do a very good job for you. So often a choice if you're grading out of store where there is no wet, loose soil coming out with the crop, seed potatoes, small gourmet potatoes, that's where we aim that roller. But of course, you lose some separation. It's not as good. So we move on to 90% of what we sell. Still capable of using this more aggressive roller on small potatoes, but we're really looking for moisture, loose soil mixed in with it. The loose soil itself will stick to the leading edges of the rollers, which makes them less aggressive as well. So if you're a main crop grower, so harvesting set skin potatoes through autumn when the conditions are a bit more moist and there's more clod, there's more soil, there's more horm to deal with, this is the highest performing roller that we do. And it's really the go-to roller. What's different about it? A few little things. The diameter. So the body of the roller is bigger on the small, on the less aggressive roller. The idea is that fills up the distance between, or the gap between, the clod rollers, so there's less opportunity for anything to escape. So it's slightly smaller, but the ribs are more pronounced and there's more of them. So as that's rotating round, you get 6 little nibbles of clods, you get 4 with that one. So it performs. The design hasn't changed much over the years. A recent addition, we do put a little bit of foam insert within the roller here and there, just to give a better overall deformation. And what's important about the deforming of the roller is the fact that it gives us the self-cleaning, which is a really important thing, and that's what really makes the machine stand alone. So if we're working on very clay soils, heavy, sticky mud that's gonna stick and try to bung up this roller, how does it keep clean? Well, it needs 2 things to keep clean. It needs the roller itself to change shape. So as that's getting soil sticking to the outside, as it takes a clod through between the rollers, what we're looking for it to do is for it to deform. And as you can see, I can just easily press it in with my thumbs. And while that roller's changing shape, as it's working, as it's taking stones and clods through, it's changing shape, and that loosens the mud that sticks to the roller itself. But on its own, that's not enough. What we also need is inertia. And when I say inertia, we need that shaft to be spinning fast enough so gravity takes effect on the loosened mud and it flings it off. So if you'd imagine you're driving your car through a muddy piece of ground and you get on the road, you get to a certain speed and then all the mud throws off the tyre. It's exactly the same. So what we're doing is we just give it enough speed and mud will flick off. A little help from changing the shape of the roller, it will run clean enough. We still have an amount of soil built up on here, but we're not bunging the roller up. And it's the air chamber that makes that critical. Without the air chamber, we don't get the deformation.
Right.
Okay. So moving on, we do another roller. This is when things are going badly wrong, quite honestly. So what's different about this one? Well, in actual fact, same diameter, same shape, same air chambers as the main crop one. This one's a bit different. So we've gone from a 10 millimeter high rib, now up to a 15 millimeter high. We've discarded three of the ribs, and the idea of that is it stops any chance of really sticky conditions and sticky mud from bridging between the rollers. The day we use this one is really when it's a salvage operation. So it's perhaps right at the very end of the season, winter's come in, and the fields are flooded. This is a roller that will keep going and keep cleaner still than even our main crop one. But there's a price to pay. And the price is, it's really borderline too aggressive for normal conditions. So while it's wet and muddy and a slimy mess, this one's gonna keep going. You won't lose potatoes. When the conditions dry out and perhaps a smaller crop there, it really is too aggressive. So you have to be mindful that it is really for those extreme conditions. Okay. That's those three rollers. A little bit more to tell you about them. There's a reason why we do two different colours. It's just really can be customer preference, but for our version, the ones we sell direct, we offer two different shaft sizes. We've got a 40 mil square, for machines up to 1.8 metres. And then we go to a 45 mil shaft. You can just see that one's slightly bigger. And the idea of that one is for when we get wider with the machinery. So machines like this that are 2.4 meters, we've got more load on the shafts. We don't want that to flex. We go to a bigger shaft. But rather than try and guess what size they are, we'll just look at the color, 40 mil, 45. We do blue ones. We can have any bore size with this. But the reason for blue, as some of you will know, it's about electronic sorters. So if you're in a typically a food processing factory where you've got electronic cameras sorting debris out further down the line, they can see blue very well. So if we have a situation where we shear off a piece of polyurethane, it's easy for the camera to see that that blue colour and get that ejected and not go through the packing side of the processing lines. That covers us on the spiral rollers. Just a couple of things just to mention. We spoke earlier about the different widths of machines that we produce. As you can see, they're segmented. So each roller, when it's compressed, because they are compressed when we're on the shaft, take up a distance of 171 millimeters. If we've got a situation where you just need that slightly longer, slightly shorter, we do shorter sections. We try to limit that so we haven't got too many out there. A typical one is this one at 122 millimeters, and we also do one at 100 millimeters. So we've got those options there as well. And then finally, transfer rollers. So these are now polyurethane. They're not hollow, but they are quite a soft material. We run a slight rib on there, which allows stones that get sitting in between the valleys to be lifted out and carry on down the table. Okay, so that's where we are with spiral rollers. A bit more than meets the eye. Thank you.